ready for the roller coaster ride of your life?
No.
No.
Welcome to Hazelight. My name is Philip Eriksson. So Hazelight Studios, or Games, started 2014. It was founded by Joseph Farris, movie director. And the main sort of motive for Hazelight Games is to blow people's mind with cool gameplay and to marry the story and the gameplay in games like no one else have done before. So this is my room, my studio here at Hazelight. And this is the main room that we do pretty much all the audio production in. We have a few other rooms similar to this one, but this is where we all gather, make mixing decisions, and do the mixing of the game. I create sound effects and do all of the work that is needed for a game.
My name is Anne-Sophie Mangeau. I'm a sound designer from Montreal, Canada. Here at Hazelight, I'm a senior sound designer. That means that 100% of my workload is sound design. So my role is mainly creative.
Typical day for me is, of course, a lot of meetings, a lot of creative discussions with my team members. And I also make a lot of sound effects. For It Takes Two, we recorded some underwater recordings with hydrophones. Rented a scuba diving suit February in Sweden, which was very cold. And we've also done numerous of other recordings, for example, whip recordings. Humongous wasps that are enemies. So we recorded some bull roarers and some other flapping for their wings and so on.
For the wasp, we build our own kazoos for the vocalizations. Of course, slime. An essential is in the sound designer's toolkit. Slime and compressed air. This has been very useful for I can't even count how many things in the game. This little guy actually became a dinosaur.
I don't think it's my pants.
At least for me, a professional working with sound, I need speakers just to be able to be able to sit and make sounds for 8 hours a day. I also think that I need to have that representation of the sound so that I can know that it's like clear enough, so that I have the depth, I have the width. And then this usually translates pretty well to headphones. We of course always test in headphones as well, but it usually comes a little bit later in the stage. So we make the sounds in speakers and then always reference listen in headphones as well. I think that headphones are great, and it's very nice that people can play in them, since they usually don't have the same environments as we are sitting in right now, professional studios. But to be able to basically know what you're doing and be able to do it for long hours, you need speakers, I think. So in my room we have 8331s in the front, left, center, right. In the rears we have the 8330s, and underneath my table I have the awesome subwoofer 7360. It's super nice to like be able to tailor the frequency response for the room that you're in, and also to be able to tailor it to your taste. I also use the new SPL calibration to just know that I have the right reference level for mixing and listening in general. So I chose the 8331s in the front, partly because it was financial. The other part was because, at least for this game, since we based it mostly on the left, center, right, those were most important. I would also say that since we are making split-screen games, we of course have to mix them with two people sitting here as well. None of us sat in the sweet spot, basically. So having a quax speaker with a wider kind of sweet spot worked really well for us.
So I think that if you work on a single player, not split screen, there's a lot both in terms of like spatialization and technical solutions that you can take for granted. You can say, okay, my player is gonna, or my character is gonna walk through this space, encounter this, there's gonna be an ambience zone here, there's gonna be a spot sound there, and this is where it's gonna come from, and it's always gonna play out the same way. But if you have a split-screen game, where two players are basically in the same space but from a different perspective, you have to take into consideration how these things are gonna sound from all these possible different perspectives at all times.
He's getting closer!
I think that a good sound designer needs to have a critical ear for both like the macro and the micro, so like the details of this one specific thing that you're working on, but also how it fits within the wider world and the wider soundscape. You want something that translates as clearly as possible what's coming out of the game, like what you put in terms of like assets and implemented work, and how that translates into what comes out of the speakers and what will come out, you know, to the end user. And you want the best reference you can get.
Bada bing and bada booms all day, leaps and loops, pew pews.